Bali. The island goes by many names, but what makes the land formation home to 4.3 million residents and many more visitors located in the southwestern parts of the Flores Sea unique is that it means different things to different people, whatever one might call it. Welcome, everyone. I can't believe I say this, but this is our very first episode of Duct Tape Theory. This episode, let alone this show, has been in the making for months now. It's been a wild journey with countless edits and going back to the drawing board moments, but we made it. We're live and I couldn't be happier that we're finally here. So with all that out of the way, again, welcome to Duct Tape Theory. I'm Sonny Fassler. I'm a journalist, writer, surfer, creator, and your host as we navigate the sheer incomprehensible depth of the world, exploring places, people, stories, and culture through the unfiltered lens of action sports. In this chapter, we're headed to an island that echoes with the sound of world-class waves and whispers with the hush of emerald rice fields. Welcome to Bali, a place affectionately known as the Island of Gods, Spiritual City, the Land of the Lefts, each name a testament to the island's multifaceted personality. To me, though, Bali is a kaleidoscope of experiences, a chameleon that adapts to the eye of the observer. It's the sophisticated boutiques and culinary delights of Seminyak, the bad decisions laid out at night in Kuta, the sprawling luxury along Nusa Dua's beaches. It's the gypsy soul of Tangu, the serene beauty to the east and north, the world-class waves scattered all over the Bukit Peninsula, the spiritual heart of Ubud, and of course, the wild frontier of the west. But what truly distinguishes Bali more than its renowned surf and exotic settings are the people who call the island home. See, the Balinese have defied the test of time, firmly holding on to their age-old customs, even in the face of rising popularity and the introduction of the digital age. The heart of Bali is its enduring cultural legacy, pulsating vibrantly across every corner of the island. For many, that's the appeal, the pull of centuries-old traditions, the alluring dance of cultures and the modern world. And then there are those of us drawn back time and time again to the charm of perfect waves and exotic flavors, the vibrant nightlife and authentic Balinese hospitality that encompasses this irresistible energy of the place. Most of us, though, are just passing through. But for some, Bali is more than just a stopover, it's home. And this is where our journey leads us today, to a group of individuals who made their mark right here on the island. People who have been instrumental in establishing Bali on the global action sports map. For this episode, I had the pleasure of speaking with legendary surfers and local royalty, Marlon Gerber and Rizal Tandjung, who've carved their stories onto the face of Bali's iconic waves. I've also connected with Afandy Dharma Fairbrother, a former pro skater turned skate park mogul who used his passion to pioneer Bali's thriving skate scene. Their stories echo the enduring spirit of the island. But the narrative isn't limited to its native sons and daughters. Bali, with its enchanting charisma, pulls in passionate souls and personalities from all over the world. Someone who embodies this testament is Swedish-Portuguese filmmaker and photographer Crille Rask. As one of Bali's many adopted sons, Rask is an ambassador of those drawn to the island from far-off lands. In our conversation, he portrays a place that, despite challenging its dwellers at times, makes it nearly impossible to leave for good. But before we can get to the people who make Bali special, let's just start with the place itself. Bali's origins trace back thousands of years. Archaeological discoveries provide a glimpse into its early civilizations, where intricate stone carvings and sacred temples tell tales of worship and devotion. From the prosperity under the Warmadewa dynasty and the powerful influence of the Majapahit Empire, Bali blossomed into a vibrant center of culture and commerce. But the island's history isn't without its challenges. Bali faced a time of severe trials during the Dutch colonial era. Suppression of local culture and political turmoil threatened the Balinese spirit. Yet, its people proved to be resilient. Local heroes like Gusti Ningurai emerged, fighting fiercely for independence, ensuring the preservation of their unique cultural heritage. This isn't a history lesson, though. Far from it, but it serves as the foundation of Bali's strong sense of identity. Because today's Bali is a different world, where old and new dance in perfect harmony, forming a vibrant hub of culture, spirituality, and adventure. Heroes like Gusti Ningurai have long been replaced. Independence is no longer the battle cry, displaced instead by a call for cultural preservation and global recognition. One such figure who answers this call is Marlon Gerber, a name that reverberates across the island with the same intensity as the ocean's tidal shifts, holding the torch high for a new breed of ambassadors that embody the spirit of Bali. Marlon has become synonymous with the island's surf culture as a member of surf royalty alongside his brother-in-law, Rizal Tandjung. Born to a Swiss-German father and an Indonesian mother, his journey into professional surfing took a path less conventional, even going against his father's initial wishes. His tale showcases the many layers that make Bali a focal point in the action sports landscape, while highlighting the challenges and changes that come with a rapidly evolving world. We'll learn how a young man yearning for home transformed his homesickness into a catalyst to become a pro surfer. We'll take a step back in time to understand life on the island before the Instagram reels, beach clubs, and the latte art. And in his own words, Marlon will help us delve deeper into the compelling fusion of history, geography, and ecology that paints a picture of his beloved home like no other.
Bali is just one of the best places on earth, to be honest. And I've traveled a lot around the world, and yeah, I think the whole world's just now realizing what a great place Bali is. And, you know, the waves are just a bonus on top of that. You know, I think the people has a lot to do, you know, the how everybody's so welcoming there. And yeah, the people makes a huge difference, I think. Because if you go to other parts of Indonesia, like the people, they're not as welcoming, I feel, you know, and Bali's special in that way. I feel the culture there is still very, very strong, despite like all this, you know, influence from outside, you know. I think the Balinese, they know their priorities, you know, they don't forget the culture. And I mean, it's still very visible every day. If you go around in Bali and they still block traffic for ceremonies, stuff like that. And people just have to, you know, they accept it. And then because they understand that this is culture and it's been going on for hundreds of years. And, you know, I think the Balinese is good at that, to preserve their culture and not forget it. Growing up, when I was growing up in Bali, it was, you know, it was just jungle. And I just remember there's like big open fields where I could ride my bike and fly kites. And there's just so much space, you know. This is in Kuta when I was a kid. But nowadays it's like, you know, all built up and kind of concrete jungle everywhere. But yeah, I have so many good memories growing up. It was really, now I look back, it was just like, you know, the best a kid could hope for growing up in that environment, you know. And I grew up in Kuta Beach, pretty much, you know, just a short walk from the beach. So, you know, naturally every day after school, I would go to the beach and surf. And, you know, that was my routine every day. It was just surfing, school, surf, school. That's all I did. So yeah, that shaped me into becoming a surfer, you know. And I met Rizal like when I was around 12 years old, and I was already surfing by then, but he just kind of like took me under his wing. And like, you know, he was like the first pro surfer. So, you know, I just did everything, copied everything he did. And he would also give me tips on how to improve my surfing. And yeah, it was just like, he was my coach kind of, you know. And so that was really helpful having him around growing up. And of course, he introduced me to all like the surf scene, the surf industry, you know, got me sponsored. And yeah, everything just snowballed from there. When I graduated high school, there was like a moment where like, you know, where do we go from here? Do we go to school, or do I go back to Bali and go surfing? And I just wanted to, you know, I was going to school in Australia at the time, and I was kind of homesick and just wanted to be home. So I went back home. And during that time I was in Australia for high school, I didn't surf much, and it made me like more hungry to surf and appreciate surfing more. And so when I got back to Bali, that's all I did, was just surf, 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 and how to like improve. That was my thing every day, you know. My dad he's Swiss German, and you know, he wanted me to go to the, you know, the school, university, get a job, like that route. But because I was like, what I had, you know, in Bali was just so perfect, you know, surfing, and that made me happy. So I just like went with my guts and just like, okay, I'm just gonna go surfing, like let's wait for school, like give school a break for a bit. And so on, and ended up just being my thing for most of my life. But now it's all like, it's a huge change from when I was a little kid growing up in Kuta to now, you know. Yeah, I don't know, for example, like the wall, there used to be no wall in between the main road of Kuta Beach and the beach. And I just remember that road was always a nice drive to look at the waves, you know, but now it's all like walled up and there's like even a skate park and a walk path, you know, on the beach. So for sure, there's a lot of changes. And and obviously the tourists, you know, it's like super packed these days in Bali, and you hardly get a wave to yourself anymore, you know, like we used to. But there are still some secret spots around. There's a lot of spots that people tend to forget to check, you know, from time to time. Like even myself, like we tend to go to like the main spots. Everybody just follows each other, but you sometimes forget, oh, that spot, you know, was pumping on that. So I was like, fuck, why didn't we think of that one? So there are still spots, just gotta get out there and get lucky, I guess. Yeah, there's a lot of beaches, you know, growing up where there was the access was difficult. You had to like hike and steps and whatever, but now a lot of these spots, they carved out a road down to the beach and made it super easy to access the beach, and with that you get all these mainstream tourism, you know, like busloads of people, which it's not always fun to be around, you know, causes traffic and people leave their rubbish around everywhere. But you know, it brings money to the villages and to the people. So there's good and bad about it, you know, it is what it is. Definitely I like the vibe in the water more in Kuta, Seminyak side, you know, like I feel everyone's more chilled on that side. Canggu, as everybody knows, it's, you know, a lot of hipsters hang out there. And yeah, I don't really go to Canggu anymore. I haven't been there in years. I don't know. Last time I was in Canggu, it was a few years ago, and I just had a bad experience in the water. Like, I don't know, I never usually get aggravated in the water, but this time this guy just, you know, I think he burned me and then like got mad at me for it. And I was just like, wow, okay, I'm going in, don't want to deal with it. I'm more like I like the Kuta side, Seminyak side more. It's more more laid back, I guess, for me, and not as traffic jam. And the East Coast, I don't know, I like the East Coast a lot. It's black sand, and you get the view of the volcano there a lot. And the waves are probably one of my favorite waves on the island or on the East Coast. There's a lot of rights on that side. And Bukit side, as you know, there's a lot of lefts. When I surf Ulu, the vibe in the water has been good lately, you know. Everybody's kind of just getting along, not super aggressive, but, you know, it depends on the day and depends who's out, and also kind of depends on yourself too sometimes, if you're in the mood to deal with the crowd or not. So there's a lot of factors, but more or less, in general, it's just more crowded now.
Bali's charm doesn't just lie in its sweeping landscapes. It is the people who breathe life into this island that truly defines its essence. From the farmers tending to the terrace paddies to the artisans carving history into wood and stone, Bali thrives on its people. Home to roughly 4.3 million souls, the island puts diversity impressively on display. The Balinese, who make up over 90% of the island's population, trace their roots back to the Austronesian people, who journeyed from Asia and Oceania around 2000 BCE. Over centuries, Bali has been a melting pot of cultures, an amalgamation of Chinese, Indian, and particularly Japanese influences, the latter being especially significant, mainly because of its geographical proximity and historical affiliations. Despite the external influences, the Balinese have held firm to their unique cultural heritage. They practice a variant of Hinduism known as Agama Hindu Dharma, evidently different from the Indian variant. It is deeply intertwined into their daily life, dictating everything from community affairs to artistic expressions, which are abundant, ranging from dance and drama to music and visual arts. Yet, it's not just about the cultural practices, it's also about the character of the Balinese people. Known for their generous hospitality and calm demeanor, they are the embodiment of the philosophy of Tree Hitakarana, a traditional wisdom which emphasizes harmony among fellow humans, nature, and the divine. As we transition from the historical and cultural milieu to the individual stories, one name stands out, Afandy Dharma Fairbrother. His story, like that of many on the island, is a blend of tradition and innovation, local roots, and global influences. A former pro skater turned skate park mogul whose love reshaped the contours of Bali's urban scene. In this ever-changing urban panorama, Afandy has navigated the intricate labyrinth of Bali's evolving identity. He's taking a sport that was once sidelined and turned it into a cultural cornerstone, not only across the island, but all over Indonesia, cementing its place in the global skateboarding community.
Like when we were young, like, oh, I want to win the lottery. Want to win the lottery, you know, oh, I want to have like this, want to have that. But then like when I look back now and when I've seen some other parts of the world, I feel like we won the lottery by our parents moving here back in the day. But when I was growing up in Petit Tingit, you know, I'd ride my bicycle everywhere. No traffic. I still remember that, you know, and like, you know, where like Mexicola is and La Favela, like that was all rice fields. And we used to ride our bikes down there and just play in the rice fields, like chase cows and stuff. And then on our way to the skate park, which is 66. So we would ride our bike all the way to 66. And, you know, like we didn't have anything back then. Like even the skate stuff, it was so hard to get, you know, like, and once we got like, you know, like a set of trucks, like new ones, you know, we go, oh, like I want to borrow it, like we'd share it, you know. And it wasn't like now where everyone's just super spoiled in terms of like everything that they have, you know, like even the locals, like they, you know, everyone's got branded skateboards and everything like that. Started skating about like seriously about 12 years old. Yeah, we used to skate at 66 intersection with all the homies, you know, just skating in like the ledges that we built and rails. Like there was no skate parks back then. There was a few skate points that we would move around to, Simpang Siur, 66, Petit Tingit. I grew up in Petit Tingit actually. Right. I used to live next to the temple on the beach. We actually started learning how to build ramps like pretty early on, like we'd build wooden ramps and then like use like really ghetto angle iron with the holes in it, which was not really good, but it was cheap and easy to work with, you know, trial and error. Like when we moved the skate point, like all the homies moved to Simpang Siur, like right in front of where Dijon is. That used to be a little skate park. Like the road was closed off on both ends and we just had like a little strip and we would build like wooden ramps there and they would get destroyed and then we'd have to like rebuild them, get sponsors and just getting rained on. And then one day I had a friend that was actually a construction worker in Australia and he showed us that concrete was good to work with too. I'm like, oh yeah, that'd be cool. So he helped us build like a ledge out of concrete. He had like all the tools like trowels and everything and he showed us how to do it and it wasn't that hard. And you know, it lasted so long. So we're just like, wow, like concrete is really something that we can work with, you know, and it's cheap. So after that, like I was around 2002, 2003. And then like back then there was only like one or two shops that were selling boards, you know, like Jungle Surf, which is Falcom's owner right now. And they were selling like US brands that were like, back then they were already like 700 thou, which was like so expensive. And then there was like a cheaper brand. Like I remember saving up all my lunch money to get this board, like a really shitty board. It was like a cheaper one. And then like, I remember like not eating for like around like a month, you know, and then finally getting this board and then just like kickflipping and just snapping it the first day. And I was just like devastated. So I was like, man, we need to like figure out how to get like a cheaper alternative, but in good quality. So in 2004, I ordered like 10 black boards from China. So they were actually came there and they were good quality. I only sold them to my friends. And then from there, like, okay, those are sold out. I ordered 20 and then 50. And then, and we came up with a name. It's like, oh, let's just put a name on the board. So I was in like Malaysia, just looking down at the buildings, just like all the cars driving by. I was like, oh, this looks like some pretty interesting motion, you know? So I was like, oh, that's the name. So we printed boards and then, you know, 50 boards and then sold them to everybody, just word of mouth, you know, just to friends and everything. There's nothing online back then, didn't have a shop. Then saved up money and then in 2007, 3 years later, we ended up opening a shop in Jalan Ligian with the help of my wife. Her mom had a shop and she let us use it, which is still open till this day, motion skate shop. And yeah, like with that, you know, saving money from the boards, being able to open the shop, acquiring some brands from the States, we were able to save money. And then what we didn't have back then was a skate park, like base skate park. I don't know if you've heard, it was like one of the biggest skate parks opened up in Central Park here. but it didn't even last a year, and it closed down. And I was like, man, we shouldn't think about building a skate park, you know? And that's when I met David, who is my partner now, who helps me with building all the skate park. He's like the project manager. And we met together and like, oh, let's just build a park, you know, like because I had a team of guys, which I still do, about six boys, and we didn't have a place to skate. So I was like, okay, let's build a park, you know? So we figured out like best way was to build like an indoor park with a roof, concrete ground. Cause we were already like pretty good at building wooden parks, you know, like from base. Cause David used to work with base and like smaller events, you know, like we would build skate parks like out of wood, which was pretty simple, you know? And then, prior to building the Motion skate park, which is still open to this day too, I had to learn how to work with concrete properly, you know, not just that one ledge. So it was like Google, like YouTube, trying to learn how to like really set the concrete slab properly. So it was 400 meters squared, and we ended up pouring it in like 4 days. And like the first section was pretty bad, like super bumpy, and like I was fucked up. But like the two other sections were like pretty on point, which is our first like concrete job that we did, just from like not really knowing how to do anything, really. Like didn't even have the right tools, and yeah, we didn't even know the right mix, but pretty much took a shot in the dark. And yeah, it's still pretty good now. Like it's still smooth, you know, it's a bit uneven, but it's still fine, like totally skatable. Yeah, first it was just like people were like, oh, I heard you know how to build skate parks, you know, like we want a bowl here. Pretty Poison was born. That was like our first bowl we ever built. First pool coping we ever tried. And it fucking worked out perfect. And then like bigger companies started to like, hit us up, you know. This big company in Sumareko, which is a corporation. It's one of the biggest like corporation in Indonesia. And they were building like a mall. And they're like, oh, we want to build a skate park. So I was like, okay, let's figure out how we can do this. You know, like it's like our first big scale project. It turned out good, you know, and the skate park was fine. But that was like one of our biggest skate parks that we did, like first street park, which we designed and built. Turned out great. And then from that, like it just started to snowball, you know, like parks started being built everywhere. And like in Bali right now, there's like, I don't know, like 20 parks. Like, I mean, including like, you know, Deo's mini ramp. Like there's only one Motion skate park. Yeah, which is the one we built back in 2009 opposite Siloam. The rest is, we're just like the contractor that built it, you know, it puts our stamp on it. Yeah, there's a few. We built a few in Jakarta. Sumatra was like maybe three or four in Jakarta. One in Kalimantan, one in Sulawesi, one in Sumatra. A few in Lombok. Yeah, we did this some design. We're starting to maybe build one in Singapore. Yeah, we've done some design work for the Chinese government as well. Having hardly any street spots here makes it so difficult to film like a video part, like a video, like for our skateboard brand or like any skateboard brand in Indonesia. It's so hard to film. That's why we always fly out, you know, like Malaysia and Singapore to go film stuff. In terms of industry, like actually there's a lot of local board brands that have sprung up everywhere in Indo, because Indo is like such a big country with like so many islands, and pretty much in every major city there is a community of skateboarders. So I'd say it's mostly scattered, but there is a lot of skateboarders. Like 2018 Go Skateboarding Day in Jakarta is like 3,000 people. I'd say the most skateboarders there are in Java for sure. Bandung, Jakarta, Jogja, Semarang, Surabaya, there's so many skaters in that area. But I'd say like in terms of facilities, like skate parks, Bali is definitely number one. I mean, like, you know, one of the kids from that used to be on our team, his name is Sangu. Like he grew up skating Motion pretty much since he was like 6-7 years old. And now he's already an older kid, and he got picked up by a US brand, and he was like a prodigy, you know? So like he was going around just like winning all the contests in Indo. A lot of younger kids just like really looked up to him, and like just these younger kids that are really good at skateboarding. Like when he was growing up, there was not many, but now like the past 5 years, there's just so many young kids that have just come up and like skate because of like, yeah, like the popularity of SLS, I'd say. I mean, overall skateboarding has kind of like a bad rap in culture, you know, like from a while back. But slowly, like these days, you know, it's a lot better, you know, like being in the Olympics. And like, again, like Sangu, he actually came second in the Asian Games, you know, and first in the SEA Games, Southeast Asian Games. And that really opened the eyes of everybody, like, wow, like skateboarding is actually like a sport that that is recognized nationally, which is like never been before, you know, like Indo, like they didn't really give a shit about that. Like, what the fuck is skateboarding? You know, like, why are you even doing that? Like, so dangerous, you know? But now, like, I see even some parents in my Banjar, they're like, oh yeah, I really want my kid to start skating. It's like, you would never hear that like 10 years ago. Which, so it's really good, you know, like this, of course, the skate parks that we've built, the quality, the design. I really know the demographic of Indonesian skateboarders, especially like kids coming up. So for instance, like the Kuta park, the way we designed it was like really mellow, easy for beginners, you know, like, so I had it in mind, like it's a skate park that's going to be able, like the all ages, all skill levels can really enjoy that park. So like a park like that really will like create a lot of interest and a lot of new people that want to skate it. Yeah, definitely. Good quality skate parks play a huge part in creating and nurturing an industry and the community. Yeah. I mean, I think it's looking really good, you know, like, especially with the SEA Games already being established, as well as the Asian Games, when skateboarding is in that. And there's going to be a new category for PON, which is like state competitions, which was never, so the skateboarding is going to be part of that. So each state around Indo, which is fucking everywhere, can send their team to participate in an event, which the winners will head to like the bigger event, which is a qualification for the SEA Games later on, which is good too. So like, that's going to push the local governments, you know, really want to see more skateboarders taken care of, you know, like, so they can actually make a living off skateboarding, getting more sponsors, you know, and that's the main goal. Maybe have a brand that comes out of Bali that can actually go mainstream. That would be awesome too.
But tales of trials and tribulations aren't confined to locals alone. Bali is a magnetic force, pulling in souls from across the world, providing refuge for a few days, a few weeks, a few months, or even a lifetime. The island serves as an international melting pot, where bars become theaters of oral traditions, and passerby turn into their captive audience. Stories are told, retold, and repurposed, echoing across the busy streets, through the kampongs, and past the sacred temples. The flavor of these stories change with the teller, their tongues lending unique spices to the narrative stew. The island may provide the stage, but it's the diverse individuals who play the role of the artists, each adding their vibrant paint to Bali's colorful mural. Transient by nature, individuals come and go, marking the island with their footprints and whispers. Some stories fade while others linger, becoming staples of the local lore. One such story belongs to Crille Rask. Born far from the Bukit's fabled left-handers, the soft-spoken and intellectually sexy Swede with Portuguese roots, often found behind the lens, writer of many crafts and fellow Rourke ambassador, is one of Bali's many adopted sons. Krill embodies the blend of locals and expats that have found themselves inexplicably drawn to the island. In our conversation, he portrays an island that challenges and tests those who try to question it, but equally offers a unique sense of belonging that makes it nearly impossible to leave.
Man, my first trip here, to be honest, I hated it. I was working a TV production in Malaysia, Survivor. I was working as actually as a nurse/security guard for the contestants. And somehow a bunch of the crew was going to come over here and like, oh, Bali, I've heard of Bali so much, you know, it's a surf destination. And I'm like, okay, cool. When the production's done, I'll join in for a week. And then, because we're in Malaysia, so it's like a 2.5 hour flight over. And man, I just got slept and dropped into Kuta, never like completely lost, hated it. It was so intense. And mainly, I think mainly because I had done zero research, or like just knew the name and kind of just struggled with it. And I was like, oh, maybe I won't come back to this place. But next year, same thing. I work with the same survivor production. Decided again, all right, I'll give it another go. And I stayed and came for 10 days. And sort of 3-4 days into the trip, I ran into Wick, one of my oldest Balinese friend, one of the most genuine people I've ever met. And I spent so many, it was pretty much, I felt like it was a version of me that was from here. And we just clicked and we started surfing, hanging. A couple of months later, I came back for 3 months and stayed at his house. Just 3 months surfing, hanging out, party. And suddenly I started loving Kuda because he showed me the different side, I would say. But I spent my first years only hanging out with Balinese people pretty much, or Indonesians, but mainly Balinese. That's why it never took me so long to learn the language, because they kept switching between Balinese and Indonesian. So I still don't speak Balinese, but I do speak quite a lot of Indonesian. But I got shown such a sick side of this place. Like, they're so creative, so cultural, strong in their Hindu beliefs, obviously, also. But there's so much punk rock, metal, like subcultures, you know, and they go all in. The guys that are punk rock, they are no different than the Social Distortion fans in OC, you know, like they just had this all-in feeling, which I really could relate to. I never all into anything, but in opinion, always like I loved strong directions of people. This, I'm a punk rocker, and I like, yeah, that's so sick. You're going all the way, and I can observe and to really enjoy it. I couldn't be that guy, but I could relate to it. And there was something in that part with, like, so anyone who loved music, for instance, they learn how to play guitar, to sing, draw, and so quickly, in a sense, where they never had been told as a kid, you can't do this. That's the biggest difference I noticed with this culture that actually attracted me. There's like, no one ever tells anyone that they can't do it. They just try. While back home, like, even my parents or anyone's parents would be like, oh yeah, my son's not good with a ball. Like, he's doing gymnastics now. Or like, we put him in music school or this and that. Like, why didn't you just tell your kid, like, you can do whatever you want, just have fun, right? And that was, again, I think the main reason why I wanted to come back. I really experienced the freedom, the sense of freedom and creativity and that the people here have, and so easygoing while being that. I don't know. It wasn't the busyness. It wasn't the waves. It wasn't anything. There was something about, to be honest, like, sounds spiritual, but the energy here that the people of Bali, I think, have created. There's something. I mean, there's a reason why it's one of the most visited islands. Not for the better, in my opinion. I don't think anywhere should be too visited and have too much tourism. But energy, man. I think it's energy. There's something, and I actually spoke to my girlfriend about this. I think it was yesterday, because there's been a lot of talk now since it's opened up, like how people are behaving, etc. Coming back to the people, the Balinese people, they're so flexible, so easygoing. And I think it just affects, you feel it. Like, you feel good in their presence and in the sort of the space that they've created, I would say. I'm still trying to figure out why I came back. I've tried to leave. I've been on my way out of here a couple of times. I've lived here for almost 11 years now, and it was never a plan. I was just going to come and hang after working in France, in Hossegor, for 6 years. And I was just wanted to get out, do something. I was going to go to Australia, but I was going to do a pit stop in Bali for a little while, just to cruise and not work for a couple of months. I just stayed. And somehow there's a free, I don't know if it inspires a certain freedom, but it's very free here. As long as you're positive and behave in a positive way, and it can give you everything, in a sense. I can't say what it is that is, but I think it's the way that people are that shapes the place. But I can't put my finger on what it is, and I don't think most people can. But you can get the same feeling here when shit starts hitting the fan a little bit here. It's almost like everyone says it has lived there for a long time, like the island will kick you in and out. But and around expats in the that's been there for a while, they'll all say the same, like, sometimes it's really hard to be here and there's no explanation. It just starts going, something might start going wrong, have a little accident, and it's just this chain event, and you're just like, I got to get out of here. And I've never had that feeling anywhere else, but at the same time, the calling back has always been so strong And there's not a wave, not a food plate. There's nothing that I can put the finger on that is like, this is the reason. And the people is the closest thing, and the energy that they are providing for the place, I have to say. But I never planned to stay here. I never planned to do what I'm doing. And suddenly I'd have my whole life set up here. I was pretty much a full-time photographer, mainly fashion at the time. Every cent I made, I put into a new thing. And a new building or a new project that could generate. I started counting the amount of times I used my lenses I bought. I was like, is this going to make it? Am I going to get my money back for this thing? Is it an investment or just a liability, whatever, you know? And anyway, it led to built a couple more properties. I built a bar called the Black Cat, which was probably the first speakeasy hidden bar in the Canggu area. And
So that was you. Yeah, right.
Was supposed to be a sushi hand roll restaurant. I ran into the owner of Tiger Sushi that was building at the time being. And so as I met with him, he said, I was making a sushi place, and I figured it'll be a really good, he had good taste and stuff. So I was like, oh, damn it. We hadn't built half the building already. So me and my business partner were like, oh man, we got to change it. And they're like, fuck, let's just do a hidden bar. Like, and then we didn't know what to put in the front. So we put it like, let's just do a shitty supermarket that has a reason to be open till late and hide the door. And man, it just went crazy. I did not know what I was getting myself into. It was stressful.
Cause that's what the Balinese do.
Instead, they will just try. They want, even if it's bloody wanting to become efficient, they'll go buy a boat and try it. And I think the freedom in that, again, not being told, oh, you shouldn't do what you're not good at. It's the biggest load of crap. I think that is the biggest appeal for me. I now get to draw. I am getting hired as an architect. I'm not an architect. I would never call myself a photographer, an architect or anything. I keep that very clear. I can do it for you, but would never place myself in a box or a title where I'm an architect. I'm like, no. Never. But I've designed and built more than 20 buildings in these 8 years. I find this the issue with the Western culture where we're so boxed in. There's only one way. When I got the job, when I started working for Rhythm back in the day, it was always like, oh, you're a marketing manager. I'm like, yeah. And I was like, how do you get into that? I'm like, I surfed with a guy in Hossegor and then met this guy who recommended me from working with snowboard events in the Arctic Circle. And that's how I got in there. And then a couple of years later, I'm like, well, I'm just doing what makes me feel good. But yeah, but what education do you have? I'm like, my degrees from a great Swedish school that I went to, great public Swedish school, they don't even exist. I didn't complete the last two courses. So I have zero grades, but I have not once in my life found a reason why I needed them again, because I don't say it's for everyone. Some people are perfectly functioning and happy following a certain system or a leader or whatever it is. And then there's some people that don't fit into that mold. But there's almost no okay way to go that own way here, bringing this back to here. The Balinese know how to have fun. So I think they cracked the code here.
Our exploration of Bali wouldn't be complete without a deep dive into the island's cultural history. Ever since I started writing the script for this episode, this segment belonged to one person, and one person only, Rizal Tandjung. For the better part of 2 months, I've tried to pin down Rizal as we tried to navigate pumping surf and last-minute flights to Sumatra. I would call, and he'd be surfing somewhere with bad signal. He'd respond to my text trying to meet up, but I'd be hunting down waves somewhere in Lombok. This would repeat itself a handful of times, but as fate would have it, we did catch up eventually, and I almost missed my flight as a result. But when Indonesian surf royalty makes time for you, you do what you have to do, even if it means making a detour on the way to the airport, renting a tiny office cubicle with no AC last minute, and setting up a makeshift recording studio with no adequate equipment and a broken microphone in what felt like the most claustrophobic and hottest room I've ever been in. All for the opportunity to capture a few words from the man some surf journalist calls easily the smoothest and most stylish surfer to ever walk the planet. The tall, thin, rubber-limbed goofy footer is an icon of the sport, often named in the same breath alongside Kelly Slater, Shane Dorian, and the rest of the Momentum generation. Tandjung was born on the Indonesian island of Sulawesi and moved to Bali with his family at the age of 1. While not a native to the island, Bali has adopted Rizal as much as Rizal has adopted its culture and way of life. And there is no one better to guide us through the intricacies of Balinese culture than someone who put Bali and the legendary left-handers at Uluwatu on the map for the rest of us to witness. Through our conversation, Rizal proved to be not just an incredible free surfer, but also a master storyteller. He detailed the complex network of customs and traditions that form the beating heart of a culture as vibrant and resilient as the island itself. But to truly understand the Balinese culture intimately, we have to understand the tree hit the Kurana's philosophy, or the three causes of goodness, first, which is the origin of the Balinese belief system. It underlines the importance of maintaining a harmonious relationship with God, people, and nature. Once aware, you see its influence everywhere, in architecture, agriculture, traditions, and how it all ties back to Mother Nature, the ocean, the waves, and in a way, Rizal himself.
Bali is, well, Bali is like, it's a surfer's paradise. If, I mean, you know, you can surf with Uluwatu, and then in the afternoon, the wind change, you can straight to Nusa Dua offshore. So it's like so much, like, no many place in the world is like some California, so blown out. It's time, it was a wave down by little Bali. Oh, blow out Nusa Dua, surf in Nusa Dua in the morning when no wind, and then when the trade come and blown out, you can surf the west side or the other side. So Bali's like, it would be the surfer, Bali is the dream. You know, so many little hook or nook or little bay, little corners, and different winds and different swell direction. You can surf all day long. And even small day too, you can go surf somewhere. Like, have a like small day, you go Nyanya, and the bigger day, you go Ulu. And then you go to the Krama side, the Changu side, any wave you want, like beach break, reef breaks, point breaks, wedges, anything you want. And here also, you can now, since the surfer industry here, you can get brand new board, and you want another, you can trade, get a new board. So you can become a certain good hub to, or a good place to become like a training, training camps, you know, for surfing to become better. You go to Bali and it's become your for your 1 week or 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, you'll become your home base. And from that, you can see the swell. Okay, damn, I'm going to go to Lazy Peak for 3 days and chase that swell, or I'm going to go to G-Man for 4 or 5 days, or I can fly to Sumatra for a couple of days and back to Bali and then go to Desert Point. So Bali is have this kind of, you know, comfort zone for all the surfers in the world to come here first to get used to of the way, and you know, the time change, jet lags, and Bali is so easy place. A lot of good food, a lot of good accommodation, depends on your budget, you know, how much you have. Because in the low class, like Losman's homestead or middle class, kind of, you know, like 500,000, 600, or to 8 million a day. So Bali have this kind of offer of people traveler come here and to have that kind of home base. And then from that, you can go, I want to go by the car and then go over the ferry, or you want to go to the planes, you know, thing like that, or so speedboat. So Bali can give you that kind of thing. So that's become Indonesia, or Bali become the hub of surfing, the melting pot, you know, back in the day in Bali when, you know, my parents moved to Bali when I was a baby, 1 year old. But I grew up with five different brothers. So we have six boys. So, you know, the big brother kind of things, you know. I'm number five from the, was following my brother where they go. So like the beach and the ocean is always our getaway. Because back then, the early days, Bali was not much to offer. Because Kuta is still a small fishing in the village and very sleepy. Back then, there's no fans or nothing. I just walk like 5 to 7 minutes straight through my neighborhood. It's all bunch of pollution, trees and things, like, you know, footpath, no asphalt road, nothing. Just straight to the beach, go to through the sand dunes, and yeah, that we grew up by the beach. So my brother, he was surfing, one of the first guys who was surfing our family, and he hang out with Katumenda. Katumenda is the one of first Bali surfing pioneers, and they're kind of pro surfer, travel the world a bit. They went to Australia, to Hawaii, and Menda have a surf shop called Bali Barrels. And my brother was really, really good friend with him. So somehow he get aboard, you know, he loves surfing, and yeah, I get introduced by surfing through my brother. He pushed me first wave on the ocean, you know, when I was like 7 years old. Since then, I was hooked. You know, no one ever know that surfing gonna be like this massive, this big. And I mean, we just do it because we love it, and we love to be hanging around at the beach, and we love the way how surfing gives us happiness and joy and gives us more community. We become a community, you know, surf all day, and then at the beach, we you know, after surf, we're always watching sunset, everybody, and the beach, you know, and get together. When the wave's good, we, you know, surf all day. When we're not good, we just hang out at the beach, play soccer, just kind of little community things, and you can count how many people in the water. But then it's not hardly tourists, you know, it's not like people selling drinks, things like that. So it's really become a small community, and then surfing becomes so big and changed the way the Bali, like it is, you know, today is so massive. Bali, one of the biggest surfing destinations in the world. How from small fishermen village here in Kutai and become more like one of massive tourist developments, like from a small homestay become 5-star hotels, you know, so, and a Circle K's around top of shops, and you know, like every name in every corner's Circle K's and mini mars and top of shops and nightclubs. So Kutai become is one of the fastest growing places in the world, you know, from that just nothing there just becomes super, super like tourist attractions, and it's not normal. Surfing just changed so fast from 8 to 12 years old. I was become like, you know, just nothing. And 12 years old, I was starting hanging out with Kutum in that Bali Barrel surf shop, hanging out by the surfers. So we just love to be hanging out in the surf shop to, you know, just hang out, just, you know, talk about surf, helping like, you know, somebody like broke their board, we're fixing the board each other, like together, helping each other, and we try to make money like, by like deep repair, like tourist board, things like that. So you learning about things, doing things, you don't realize you become a little entrepreneur, and like, you know, fixing boards, you get money, oh, 25,000, what? Just a little thing like this, you know, and then, yeah, and then thing like that. So, serving to kind of help people to become kind of self-independent, self, and you know, entrepreneur, like you're a hustler, you know. Surfing, it is a hustle. You every day you hustle, try to get waves from everyone, so you kind of have that kind of natural kind of, you know, instincts, you know, how to survival, you know. Surfing is a survival. If not, you will. So it's like in Bali, you're surfing dry reef, Uluwatu thing, if you don't survival, you're done, you know. So that kind of taught you in life about teaching you about to become who you are. But back then, only once a year, we have contests or competitions. And then after that, we have this kind of, what do you call it, about scholastic contests. Like every summer, a bunch of people from all over the world coming. They're doing like this top under 16 and under 18 top surfers from all over the world, Australia, America, Hawaii, like New Zealand, South Africa, Japan. They all come. And we do this World Ramen Contest as sponsored by Kutsur. And I was like one of the winner. I was the first Indonesian junior champion from that, and I was like, you know what, I want to be a pro surfer, you know. And then Kusaru sponsored me and sent me to travel to Australia and Hawaii, and then boom, the surfing start, you know. So it changed the culture for sure. Culture is the big part of all Balinese loading lifestyle, because you see every day those Balinese people, they do offering to the god, and they believe in karma, and the Balinese people never hope, you know, always give. They don't want anything in return. They just do it for themselves. And that what is Balinese people, you can see a lot of people, they felt like home here, even they're far away from real home they're from. And Bali is like making them feel comfortable and easy people to come in, you know, like and become their home. And the culture, a big part of that, because the Balinese, they work so hard and try to keep this place, you know. I think not too many people, not many places in the world have this kind of vibe, you know. When you land in Bali, you can feel it in a different energy, or, you know. Just also, you think about Bali, Indonesia is, if 20-something million people, and then the only small, we have 17,000, more than 17,000 islands, and Bali, the only island that Hindu, you know, and then gives that. And the last kind of Malikan, you know, like the last kind of place that have this kind of vibe, you know. I love it, the Balinese people, like they touch me, like give me like kind of a peaceful mind, you know, like the way they pray, thing like that, have them give you like a mantra, you know. Yeah. they pray to the god, to the, you know, to, because that's what they call Bali, the island of the god, and they always praying, thing like that, and they always do ceremonial with offering, thing like that, they dancing, thing like that. So for me, when I was younger, when I went, when my first from my grade 1 to 6, I would go went to these Catholic schools in Denver, and then when I started into surfing when I'm 12 years old, I moved to junior high school to Kuta. And Kuta is what go more like local school. And then they, down there, they taught me how these Balinese dancing classes. And back then, I hated Balinese dance. And then, but now looking back, man, I love it because they teach me how to style. Look at this, the culture, the Balinese give me like, you know, then when they dance, so their fingers, so they give me like kind of, because I'm tall and lanky, so they give me kind of how to look nice and clean. My finger movement is a big deal in surfing. You can see just the way my fingers surfing, sometimes your hand movement is very unique. You're not just like, you know, I think for me, like even your little finger hand like that is like your little wing in surfing, you know, like give you even direction. You turn your finger like that a little bit to the right, it can give you a little kind of, you know, a little torch, a little, you know, pressure, or your, you know, so that's influenced me from the Balinese culture to my surfing, you know. Like you see every corner saw when good wave usually a big temple. You go to Uluwatu, the biggest temple in Uluwatu, and one of the best wave. You go to Chengdu, the first thing you see is the big temple. So the oceans and the culture and the spiritual, they're always connected to the ocean, to the water. Also the Balinese, when you passed away, when you die, they bury your body and they throw your ass in the ocean. So it's automatic. The circle of life, they have that already connected with that. Like, and the ocean, you're the most peaceful things, you know, ever, you know, go out there in the water, sitting and waiting for the wave and give you different kind of energy. And like, you know, yeah, before it's not serving what one, not very like, we are the black sheep of the whole group, you know, community, because we are like somber, bleach hair, blonde, and red eye from several day. They look at us like, what the hell is this kid, you know? And then now look at this, serving become, is, you know, Bali most biggest tourism surfing, and then because surfing give life to all these people. Because I think with surfer, they stay in the warung, and you know, they rent a bike, they buy petrols on the little streets. So the money is going to everywhere, not like much of most mass addict tourism. They just stay in the like from news that way area or nowhere, nice hotel, and just, you know, just corporate hotel. But it's different. But the surfers, they travel and they stay the more to the, you know, to the local style, and then it changed the way how people think of the surfing now. We accept it, and also now surfing become finally, like last year we are in the sport committee in Indonesia. Like, the government finally like, oh, they see us because we are in the Olympics, right? Now they see us like, oh, surfing can bring gold medal. And then now the money there, that could help. So it changed slowly the way they see us. And surfing is one of the biggest upcoming sport now. And look at it now, like Krui, Nias, they put money into sport for us, sport tourism money, because they see, like crewing in Sumatra from maybe like a couple thousand tourists a year, now become, you know, double each year, doubles. That they see is serving, bring tourism, bring money to the area, to the region. And now that's why all the Indonesian people want to be surf, you know, and they change the way the family, the way the culture, the way the religions, you know, because back then, you know, people always have this kind of myth of story. Not myth, like a big story about this, the goddess, or sea goddess, take you when you were green, take you away from the family. But now it's changed, you know. You have to enjoy the moment. You cannot change. Well, Bali looks so much better in the 70s, you know, 80s. Even I asked Jerry Lopez, even look back then and before, we stay in Kuta and we go to Uatu serve and go back to Kuta. And now I can stay in Uatu, stay at you know, lots of surf villas, and my wife can come enjoy this thing like this. Well, before I cannot, but Bali still has the magic, still have the power, and you know, the smells, and you know, the energy of this, the like what people fell in love for from the first place is never changed. But the mass tourism, of course, everyone want to be a surfer, thing like that. We cannot change it. But now we need we need to become more smarter as a new generation, as Indonesian, as a local, how to manage the tourists, how to manage the waste, how to manage our area, for example, preserve some area and not get raped and build, overbuilt, you know, and where the rubbish and trash gonna go, things like that. I think with the new generation, smart, like, for example, like from Sungai, the guy from Sungai Watch, they're starting to clean the rivers and educate the people. And then like this girl, you know, do the bye-bye plastics. They're doing all this top normal plastic in the supermarket. So we do some movements and some just take times, you know, cannot change in like automatic in like that, you know, take times. But we are trying as hard as we can to protect and preserve, you know, Bali become still, you know, beautiful in a new way. Yeah. Of course, like the tourists or whoever, the visitor come to Bali, they should do respect to the local, just not feel like take. If something like you would feel you want to give back, maybe you can donate something to the, you know, like people, like a lot of things. Like last time, and this Korean guy, my friend from Surfer, he called me, Riz, I want to donate this like 50 backpacks full like books and pencil thing. Like, can you know some any orphanage people can have this? And for sure, no problem. And he gave him all these 50 bags. And me and my friend went to this gift to this guy in British area in by past Chandidas area when they need it, you know, thing like that. You can do simple thing like that, you know. More of the things you can do is, for example, like you can do that wasteful water, that filter thing. You can go back from America and buy some filters, put in, throw your bar bags and give to when you go to Sumba or somewhere that you, or Bali, some area that you see the family needed. You can give that filter so they can save, right? By water, they can filter any, you know, any water from the well or any from the thing you just drink it, no need to buy from, you know, supermarket, thing like that. You can save money, you know what I mean? Thing like that you can do to give back to the club, to people, to the country.
As we approach the end of our Bali journey, I find myself peering through the looking glass of memories and conversations. The lullaby of the waves, the whispers of the ancient temples, the hushed sound of the emerald green rice fields, they all blend into a harmonious symphony that tells the story of this island. Yet, within this beautiful mosaic of time and space, certain pieces sparkle more luminously than others. It's the individuals, the custodians of the island, who have shaped and been shaped by Bali's ever-evolving rhythm. It's their stories, complicated and profound, that resonate with the spirit of the land. And above all, it's the resilience, an unyielding spirit that ebbs and flows like the mighty sea, a spirit that mirrors Bali's own timeless endurance. I explored and I experienced, I listened and I learned. Yet, as I reflect upon my time with Rizal and Marlon, Krill and Afandy Dharma Fairbrother, I'm reminded of one fundamental truth, that every story told is a mirror of the teller. Thank you for listening. I'm Sunny Fassler and this is Duct Tape Theory. Until we meet again.
Ya Amin, Ya Amin.